So, I just watched Mulholland Drive for the very first time. Where do I start? Probably with a little glass of this, I think. For me, David Lynch and a good Fireball and Coke go hand in hand. Cheers. And don't drink all the Coke. Okay, so, hello and welcome back to Lynch Fest, which is something, if you're unaware, that I'm running throughout the majority of 2019. It's been a few months since my last Lynch Fest video, and in fact, this is the first review slash me talking about a David Lynch film I'd never seen before video in Lynch Fest. I think the first few videos I did were the introduction, my David Lynch Blu-ray collection, and an episode of The Twin Peaks Journey, which was recorded years ago. So this is my first kind of fresh look at a David Lynch film I'd never seen before, and my review of it. But I'm not going to title this one a review. It's going to be thoughts. Not even a discussion, just thoughts. Just my initial bleh about Mulholland Drive, a 2001 film written and directed by David Lynch, and was originally, and you know, I've been looking into the making of this film ever since I first saw it about a week ago, and I'm already getting bored myself of hearing the same story about how it started its life as a TV pilot. But you know me, I love to get my housekeeping out of the way and kind of touch on these little bits of interesting to me trivia, even if they have been kind of like driven down into the ground to anyone who's a fan of this sort of thing. But yes, it was originally a TV pilot in the late 1990s. I think 1999 was when they shot this. And it was going to be a TV show. A new TV endeavor from David Lynch. And there was going to be strands that would be explored in a whole season. And then ABC were like, nah, we're good. We don't like that. See ya. So, for years, almost, this project was, you know, doomed to never even see the light of day. Some people believed that it would, some people believed it would get picked up, some people didn't. They thought that it was, you know, all that time and work and money and effort for nothing. But someone stepped in and gave David Lynch the money to film more stuff for this pilot and turn it into a feature film. And this is where I'm really happy that they shot that pilot on film. So it doesn't kind of, you don't have that kind of switch where it's like, you know, shot on video for the majority and then a few scenes filmed on celluloid itself, and then you have that kind of like, you know, mishmash of different looks and feels for the footage. It's all, it to me, in watching it, it looked like a film that was made in one go. There was no point where I was like, that looks different from the rest of the footage, or, oh, you know, someone's hair looks a little shorter there. Like, you know, at no point did I even guess that this was effectively shot in two segments, you know, over a couple of years. To me, it's seamless. And in fact, they did take the sets that they built for the pilot, and they kind of stripped them down, took them away, put them into storage, and were able to take them, bring them back, and use them again for the feature-length film iteration of this project that they finally completed after the initial TV pilot production. Already I feel like this is a bad video because I'm going into the boring technical backstory of the film. And I don't want this to be a review either, because I feel like I can only review this film properly when I've seen it a few more times. And honestly, if I'd had my way, if life went exactly the way I wanted it to, I would have already have seen this film three or four times over the past week. I think I could have happily sat down and watched this again and again over the past week. But time doesn't really allow for that, right? You know, full-time work doesn't really allow for that. But I saw this film a week ago, roughly in the middle of the night, which I feel like is the best possible time to take in a David Lynch piece of work, is in the dead of the night, on your own, actually, preferably, and with headphones on, listening to all that sound design, which is instrumental to a lot of his great works, I think, and just just taking it in, just focusing right in on this film, and in the dark, you know, no other distractions. And I was stunned. I sat with the menu of the Criterion Blu-ray running on my TV for about 15 minutes, just like mulling it over in my head. It really hit me. Not in an emotional way, but just in a wow, you know, wow, Bob, wow. Like, that was something. And it just hasn't left my head. It hasn't left my consciousness. I have put it on almost every night while I go to sleep, and I drift off listening to that haunting score from Angelo Badalamenti, and it's usually the opening scene that I fall asleep to, because I put it on when I'm really just about to go to sleep. But I like drifting off to it, and I just don't know. I don't know how to even begin discussing this film. You know, it was like my introduction to this video was talking about how it was a pilot, then it became a movie, and that's kind of a nice, easy, safe way to kind of begin discussing the film. But now I find myself reaching the part where I need to talk about the film a little bit, and I just don't know where to start or what to say. I feel like I have nothing to say. And I also feel like I have too much to say, if that makes any kind of sense. I would have loved to have filmed this the day afterwards. I just couldn't get myself to sit down in front of a camera for this. And I love that. I love that. I'm so excited about this film. And I truly believe that this will become a favorite film of mine. I don't think it is just yet, but I think it has so much potential to be one of my very favorite films. And I can see the potential in it there. Again, it's not quite there yet, but there's something about it that just I can't stop thinking about. And if you don't know me, I watch films all the time. I'd say every month I probably watch a couple of films, two or three, that I think, wow, that's an amazing film that I've seen for the first time. I watch a lot of, you know, first-time watches. I always try and focus on that when I'm watching films for the most part. So I tend to find a lot of great ones that I really think are fantastic, but not many of them actually dig in deep and kind of, you know, clasp, you know, my consciousness with the fingernails and just dig in deep, and just I can't pull it off and put it to the back of my head. It stays there. Whether it is the whole feel of this film, or whether it's something as simple as the opening sequence, which is the jitterbug dancing competition, and that little beat, that little rhythm and melody, whatever you want to call it, I'm not a musical person, that song has been stuck in my head for the past week, and I fucking hate it. I hate how it's stuck in my head. I don't mind the actual piece of music itself. It's fitting to the scene, but I don't know. It's running in my head like in a maddening loop, and I think the rest of the film is as well. So, Mulholland Drive stars Naomi Watts and Laura Haring, or Haring, I'm not sure exactly how you pronounce her last name, and also Justin Theroux. This is a film really of three characters, I think, and one could argue that it's a film of one character, and I wouldn't disagree with that. But if you want to break this film down and introduce it in the very most basic term I could possibly imagine, it's about three characters. One is a woman who eventually calls herself Rita, played by Laura Haring, who at the beginning of the film gets into a car accident up in the Hollywood Hills and has amnesia, wanders into a house and meets Naomi Watts' character, who is Betty, and she is an aspiring young actress who's moved to LA with big doe eyes, kind of, you know, trying to live the Hollywood dream. She's full of idealism and kind of enthusiasm and optimism, and she meets this woman, Rita, who can't remember who she is and wants to find out who she is, and they try and solve that mystery together, and that is really the driving force of the entire story until we get to the third act of the film, I would say. I don't even know if you can break this film down into a traditional three-act structure, but the first two-thirds of the running time are pretty much dedicated to that mystery of who Rita is and Betty trying to help her find out who she is. The third character, played by Justin Theroux, is a film director who is making a new film, and he's casting his new film, and the mob has gotten involved in the casting and wants him to cast someone very particular for his movie. And he doesn't want to just bow to this outside influence. He wants to cast the person who's best for his movie. But he's being pressured into doing the opposite of that and going along with what they want. This kind of almost faceless entity of Well, it isn't faceless because you see a lot of these shady characters, but you know, it feels like it's an overarching, looming presence of almost, you could say, Lynch's comment on the Hollywood movie industry, you know, and how again an outside influence and other interests get involved in the element of making a movie, and how creative freedom and being true to your creative ideas can sometimes be quashed by an outside force that isn't really interested in creativity or art in the slightest and are more interested in their own agendas and what they can gain from it. So that's the three characters, I think, that figure into the film the most. The Justin Theroux element of the film I enjoyed quite a bit. But at the beginning of the film, the opening credits, it says, you know, Mulholland Drive, and then it says Justin Theroux, Naomi Watts. And so he was billed first, which made me think he was the main character, which made me think he was going to be the main storyline. And every time we cut back to him, I was like, oh, God, you know, I'm not looking forward to the point where the director's story becomes the focus, because I was really taken with the Rita and Betty mystery. But that is the main focus of the film, and I guess he just got top billing, and that's all there is to it. So I was really happy by the end of the film that, not that I was happy he wasn't in it very much, but I was happy he wasn't the main focus. I enjoyed his character's scenes and the way he played the character quite a bit, and how it figures into the overall story for sure, but I was just glad that it was more focused on that, the two women, basically. And I'd heard a lot about this film. People speak of it very highly. It's in a lot of lists, you know, like the greatest films of the 21st century and so on and so forth, which I almost you know, do a double take when I hear something like that. I was like, really? The best films of the 21st century? Like, we're not even 20 years into the 21st century yet. It's like saying, you know, releasing a top 20 best films of 2019 in March, you know. But, I mean, I'm sure, you know, none of us are going to be around in, you know, 2100. So, you know, I understand kind of the need to kind of cut off, you know, from the year 2000 onwards and say, what are the best films of our current kind of, you know, recent history. So I suppose I get that, but it does figure into a lot of, you know, great films of the past 20 years. And I know a few people personally who are big fans of it. And one who I have to kind of credit with giving me the push to watch this at this point in time is Daisuke, who has a great channel. If you haven't seen him, go check him out. But he has talked about this film a few times, not in a dedicated video on his channel, but a few times where he has been very enthusiastic about it. And I think he talked about it recently on a live stream, and I thought, you know what, I want to watch that. The timing is right for it now. I'm doing Lynchfest. Let's check out Mulholland Drive. I got the Blu-ray, I think, a year or two ago from CP. So thank you very much again, CP, for helping me out with this one. And honestly, when I opened the package with this Blu-ray, of course I wanted to watch it straight away. I was so enthusiastic. I think at the time I'd just come off watching, you know, Twin Peaks The Return for a second time. Huge Lynch kind of, you know, phase in my life. But I left it. I wanted to wait. I wanted to savor the first viewing of this film. And I'm glad I did, because it all kind of slotted into place when I checked this out for the first time last week. And it's been 15 minutes of my recording. I don't know how much I'm going to cut out, but already I don't even feel like I've gotten into the story. That's this film, you know. I'm going to hold back on editing too much of this out, because I want you to see my, just the way I roll through this in my head, how I try and work out discussing this film. First thoughts, initial reactions. So, you know, first hour of the film, I can tell you this. And I actually had it in my head to kind of draw out the suspense a little bit with this video and not tell you if I liked it or not. And I was going to say that I got 57 minutes into this film and I was hugely disappointed, which would then lure you into thinking I didn't like it. But the joke would be, I literally was disappointed 57 minutes into the film, because I paused it to go and get a drink and I thought, oh, there's only an hour and a half left. I was genuinely gutted. I could have sat through a 5-hour version of this. And maybe it is, I don't want to say blind loyalty, but just an appreciation and an enjoyment of what Lynch does. I love all the little moments that he decides to fixate on that really don't add all that much, I don't think. There's a sequence in the film where a shady character is hanging out in an office in LA with another shady character, and he murders him. And it's like, holy shit, that came out of nowhere. Like, this is now I'm really like drawn into this scene, what's going on? And then it just turns into a complete farce. He takes the gun that he's killed this guy with and puts it into his hand to make it look like a suicide. And as he's rubbing his hand with a cloth to kind of, you know, to clean off the prints and then and just get the gun into the dead guy's hand to make it look like he was the one who shot himself, he accidentally fires off the gun, which is silenced as well. Something about the fact that it was silenced made it even funnier. It's just this little pfft, and then you just like see a hole in the wall and a woman go, oh my god. And he goes around into the office, he fights this woman, he ends up killing her, and he's like, oh man. And it's just, I was rolling. It was so funny in the most inappropriate kind of way. And I loved that scene. What does it add to the overall film? Does it need to be there? No, you know, but does any scene need to be there? But I just think that there are moments like that where, you know, he just goes in these digressions, and I love them. You know, I just really enjoy them. There's just a quality to them that I find really watchable. He'll take things like the cowboy character, who the director meets at a ranch about halfway through the film. I think that was actually around the point I stopped to pause for a second. And the cowboy is, I believe, played by a man who's a friend of Lynch's and isn't an actor. And he gives this chilling and mesmerizing performance. I thought, wow, what a great actor. You know, I thought, I feel like I've seen him somewhere. He must be a great kind of character actor who's done many things. He's not an actor, he's just Lynch's friend, and he couldn't remember his lines for shit. And they would tape his lines to the forehead of Justin Theroux in his chest, and he'd just read them off. But you watch it, and even in the special features, which I'll talk about in a separate video, Justin Theroux said that, you know, he just thought, this isn't working. The guy can't remember his lines. He's reading off my chest. You can see his eyes going back and forth. And he said to David afterwards, like, we didn't get that, you know. And Lynch is like, no, it'll be fine, it'll be fine. He watched the final scene and he thought, it's amazing. It's brilliant. Like, it works. And it does. For at no point did I think this isn't an actor or, you know, he's reading his lines. Like, and it's just, and it's this weird kind of stilted way that he delivers his dialogue, which just is conducive to making the scene even more weird and engrossing, I think. So, you know, again, those weird little things that Lynch will do, he'll get an idea and follow it. And sometimes it'll work, sometimes it probably doesn't, but that was an instance, I think, of something really, you know, risky that really paid off. That cowboy scene was brilliant. I loved it. It was captivating. And just, so there's a few moments like that in the film. Although with the cowboy scene, that is kind of part of the plot and a bit more vital. Even though the scene with the murder in the office, that character who does the shooting with the silencer, he does appear later on in the film, so it does kind of set him up as this shady character. I think, in fact, he steals a book, which is kind of worked into the plot as well. But still, it's just one of those scenes where, you know, if you wanted to be more conservative, if you wanted to be more streamlined with your script, you wouldn't have those scenes, but Lynch puts the scenes in all, you know, all the same. And I love that about it. Really, the main sell for me on this, the main reason I love it, is the performance of Naomi Watts, who is just an incredible actress, I think. I loved her in Twin Peaks The Return. I've enjoyed her in other things, but that was the one that I loved her in that TV series slash film. In that TV show, she was brilliant as Janie E. And here I was really excited to see her, you know, early on in her career, compared to, you know, where she is now, which is almost, you know, 20 years later. And it was really fascinating to learn that she'd come to LA, come to America from, I think she's Australian. And she had this, you know, again, I'm assuming the American dream. She had this, you know, dream of becoming an actress and everything like that. And it just wasn't working out for her. She'd get a job and it would seem like it was going to work out and it wouldn't. And she was so close to quitting everything, so close to packing it up and going back home, so close to thinking, you know, this hasn't worked out for me. And then this happened. And then it didn't work out. The pilot didn't get picked up. But then they finished it as the movie. And she said, you know, in an interview on the Blu-ray, she said that, you know, once she'd done this film, once it had come out in all the film festivals, she was getting offers. You know, this turned her life around completely. And it's a weird kind of art imitating life, life imitating art, in a sense. you know, because I wouldn't say the film is, Mulholland Drive isn't about her succeeding as an actress. It's about something a lot more darker and deeper and I would say interesting than that. But, you know, the fact that she's playing a character who is trying to live that American dream and ultimately in real life she realized that through making this film is just a really cool and interesting side note to the whole, you know, thing. So, Betty and Rita, they're trying to unlock this mystery, and there's lots of little elements and things in the film that kind of point towards clues and what you might, you know, want to analyze and dig deeper into. I believe there's something to do with license plate numbers. There's a website full of theories, and, you know, people go really deep on this film, and I can understand that because there's so much that you could analyze and take away from the film, because to me it's 2 hours of a traditional story and half an hour of what the fuck is happening. What is happening? Like, it's tricky. For me it was difficult to deal with, actually, at first. Because I'll admit it, I was so wrapped up in the story of Betty and Rita that I wanted to see a natural conclusion. I wanted to see, not necessarily a happily ever after, but I wanted to see the mystery solved, and I wanted to see those two characters to quote-unquote make it. I wanted to see those characters make it out at the end, you know. That's not what happens. There isn't a neatly drawn conclusion to the story, and I should have seen it coming. I really should have seen it coming. It's David Lynch. Like, I should have thought back to when I watched the end of Twin Peaks The Return and I was just devastated. You know, I should have remembered that. In fact, I know that this film gets dissected. I know that people talk about this film in the same breath of, you know, films like Persona. That should have been like ding ding. Like, I should have seen it coming. You know, I felt like Lloyd Christmas. Like, I was robbed by an old lady in a motorized car and I didn't even see it coming. And I should have. But I didn't. And so the rug was pulled swiftly from out under me. And I was thrown into this half an hour of... And I'm saying 2 hours and half an hour of, you know, what the hell. That's not an accurate... There's probably, like, you know, a little bit of a difference there in terms of actual minute-to-minute kind of where the split happens. But for all intents and purposes, you pretty much get a two-hour traditional narrative and then half an hour of diving off the deep end. And I don't know what I think. I have a vague idea. I think that there's a general kind of, you know, this is what it means, this is what happened, that most people can kind of put together for themselves. But I think it's so open to interpretation, so richly available to anyone who wants to kind of dive in deep. And I don't think I ever want to. I think there's a lot of things in the film that you really need to pay attention to. But I enjoyed not paying attention to them the first time around, which is why I don't think I can review this film until I've seen it a few more times, maybe in a few years, you know, to really let it sit. And I think it'll be a film that changes every time I see it. But I love the way that it was shot. I love the look of the film. There's a glossy kind of feel to the first 2 hours that I don't know whether it is that old trick they used to say where they put Vaseline on the lens, but there's this glow to certain scenes, particularly with Betty, and especially the scene when she arrives in LA at the airport, and she's like looking around like this is America, this is Los Angeles, this is the city of dreams, this is where I'm going to be a Hollywood megastar. And she is so bowled over by it, and there's just this soft kind of glow to it, this ethereal music that's played in by Badalamenti that just perfectly complements that. And I feel like that's, you know, the same can be said for the most of the film, is that his music, much like it was in Twin Peaks, is so complementary to well, what's shot and what the characters go through, you know, and their feelings and things. But also I think that his music enhances what's going on as well. And I love the working relationship between Lynch and Badalamenti, because I think they're both great artists, and they almost bring out the best in each other, in a sense. And you can just, you know, look at any interview where they talk about their creative process together, and it's really interesting to me. But it was very reminiscent of Twin Peaks, which I really enjoyed. I was not surprised to learn that this was initially conceived as somewhat of a Twin Peaks spin-off series with Audrey Horne. But yeah, the vibe of it, I would say, very much is in tone with the Twin Peaks world, and not so much in the weirdness and other things that happen in Twin Peaks, but just the music, you know, the writing, the kind of the way Lynch writes his characters, the way that he shoots his characters, the various little tweaks and flourishes he does directorially with the camera, little things that he does. Obviously, it feels like it's from the same world, a distant cousin of Twin Peaks, I think. And especially when you get to the end and things are really not, you know, what they seem. You know, the owls are not what they seem. And I would say that the actresses in this film are perhaps not what they seem. Now, I don't know whether I can even go into spoilers with this. And I still feel like I haven't really talked about the film that much. But I think that's the best way to do it. You know, I don't think you need to be telling people what happens if they haven't seen it, and perhaps I'll do a little spoiler section at the end for people who have seen it, and I can kind of give you a little bit more of my thoughts on the rest of the film, and kind of the key moments that happen throughout. One thing I love about this film, I really, really love about this film, is the horror elements. I don't think this is a horror film. I know some people think that it is and argue that it is. I'm happy for people to do that, but I don't feel like this film fits into any genre neatly or cleanly, but there are these two moments that are more successful for me personally, and it's always going to be different for everyone, but for me personally, there are two moments in Mulholland Drive that are so much more successful at eliciting dread and the closest I can get to fear when watching a film. I never get scared at films, but I can get almost close to that feeling. But really it's dread that kind of comes out with me if a horror film is really successful. But there are two moments that elicit that reaction from me better than the entire running time of most horror films that I've seen in my lifetime, I would say. You know, there are only a few horror films that I think really from start to finish work as this overall film that elicits that kind of response from me, if that makes any sense. I don't know. I feel like I'm talking myself around in circles. But anyway, the two moments are... the first one is the diner scene, right? And I've seen Sally Hawkins, who I love, talking about this scene in particular and how much it scares her to the point where she can't even like look at it. She gets so tense. It's a great video. You should check it out. It's on YouTube somewhere. But I kind of get what she's talking about, and it's something that I feel not just in Lynch's work, but in other films that I've seen it used as well to varying degrees of success. To me, one of the scariest things you can do in a film is... focus in on something where the scary part is not on the screen. It's unseen. It's the fear of the unknown. And in the diner sequence, there's a man who talks about... And then again, that scene, where do those characters fit into the overall story? You know, but I love that scene is there because it's a great scene. And he talks about this dream that he's had of a man out back. And this face that he can't get out of his head. And he wanted to come to this diner to see if it was real. And they walk towards this, what's just like a simple, unassuming wall in an alleyway, you know, next to a diner in LA. You know, broad daylight. There's nothing inherently creepy about the way this thing looks and is lit. But the way the camera is slightly moving, so it feels like you're the person who's actually walking towards it. You get drawn into that scene in that sense. The camera's slightly moving. And then you're honing in on this wall, and you're just ever so slightly getting more of a peek at what's behind it. And then the score is rising up very subtly, at least in my memory, and it's about what's behind the wall. And you almost don't need what's behind the wall, you know, and you get to see what's behind the wall, and it's like, ooh, it's a little bit creepy, but just that build up to it, I think Lynch just excels at that kind of stuff. There's a similar scene, well not similar, but that similar idea of the fear of the unknown, what's lurking around the corner in the Dario Argento film Suspiria, towards the end, the curved corridor. I love that sequence so much. Again, it's just that, what's down there? I mean, you can do it in a horror film where it's a dark corridor. Is there someone standing in that corridor I can't see? But there's something about where you can see kind of a wall or something, and you're moving in, and it's... what's behind there? You know, I don't know. I just thought that was really fucking well done. And the second time is when Betty and Rita are in an apartment and they're walking into a bedroom. And the suspense and the dread that fills you, that filled me, was it was really exciting. You know, I don't feel that very often. And it's like, wow, if every horror film made me feel like that, I'd be on board with everyone else who loves horror films so much. But Those two sequences were really effective for me, and I really enjoyed them. Naomi Watts, she really plays a character who has a very interesting transition, shall we say. Laura Harring, I thought, was really good as Rita, but, you know, as you get to the end, you kind of realize what her character is and what she's supposed to represent. And so I don't think she gets an opportunity to really give a stellar performance. She's very, very good. Very, very good in the film. But I think Naomi Watts gets so much more range that it overshadows everything. In a good way, I think. It's really her movie. And there's a beautiful 1-2 punch of scenes. In the first half of the film, there's a sequence where she's reading her lines for an audition with Rita. So Betty and Rita are doing this scene, and they're acting it like where it's not very good acting. You know, I love that. I love when I see an actor deliver convincing, not very good acting in kind of an audition or in a movie within the movie. And it's a fun sequence. You know, you can tell they're having fun together. It doesn't need to be good, and it works. And then later on, Betty gets to go to an actual audition. And that whole scene is like a very interesting, I would say, you know, critique, you know, criticism of the Hollywood system in a way. But Betty gets taken in to do this audition, and she fucking crushes it, like, holy shit. You know, and I was just marveling at, like, Naomi Watts' acting within a performance, you know. It's like she's playing a character who's acting as another character, and she just nails it, right? But it's all the same dialogue as that scene from before, which was a little bit stilted. The dialogue wasn't very good, but it shows you what you can do with tone, you know, just by taking a line of dialogue and slowing it down, delivering it with a different intent than, you know, what, I mean, there's so many variables in making a film, and it just highlights that. I like that just as from a technical perspective, but then just drawn in from the perspective of watching someone act their ass off, and the, you know, the kind of, the friction, that the erotic friction that just blossoms from that audition scene is just, wow, like, amazing scene. I thought it was fantastic. One of the best scenes of the whole film. Just really, really great acting. And great acting at acting, if that makes sense. I don't know. Love that scene, and it's pretty important, I think, overall for the whole film. Then there's the whole sequence in the, is it Club Silencio? I think that's what the actual club is called, a theater that Betty and Rita go to. That scene is that's a whole other animal. You know, I feel like a book could be written about that sequence and everything that it could mean. And that's really the last point before we transition into something completely different at the end of the film. Yeah, I feel like I could just keep rattling on about these little things that I like. I like the scene when the director found his wife cheating on him, and the weird humor that arose from that, and his very kind of, okay, I'm going to get my revenge. And just, like, I loved what he did to get his own back on his wife. Again, just does that scene need to be there? I don't know, but I loved it all the same. But the last 30-minute stretch is just like, you know, Naomi Watts again crushes it, but in a completely different kind of way. And it's so stark and unsettling. And, you know, when you read into it and, you know, think about it, really, like, the things that you see at the beginning of the film maybe make more sense at the end. And I don't think it is a film that has a definitive, you know, answer to what everything means or anything like that. But it's more about the feeling and the tone of it, which I understand if people think that that's a cop-out. I understand if people think that, you know, you have these filmmakers like Lynch who make things confusing in their films and say, well, it's open to interpretation, to mask the fact that they're just haphazardly throwing things together, you know, laying down the track frantically in front of the train as it's rolling along. I understand that, and I would accept that. But it's tricky for me, because sometimes I feel the same way. And I feel like, bollocks, like, you know, your job is to make a film, to tell a story. Tell us the story. Don't mask it behind a mystery box. I mean, there literally is a mystery box in this film that doesn't really have any payoff, I don't think. you know, a MacGuffin, you know, to the highest order. So I could understand it, but when I'm in love with the performances in the film, and the what, just every little part of it, that stuff kind of just drifts away and kind of just falls so far down the priority list of things that, you know, make me enjoy a film that I don't even care, you know, that it doesn't quite make sense, or you know, doesn't wrap everything up in a neat little package by the end, by the time the credits roll. So, and thinking about it now, I don't remember the final shot of the film. I don't remember what the last sequence is. It's all a blur, that last 30 minutes, and that kind of, it's almost what it feels like it should be. You know, he plays with, you know, the non-linear storytelling, and that's in that whole, like, ending stretch, I think, quite successfully. And it feels in line with the other things he's done throughout his career that I've seen to date. And maybe, as far as his feature films go, it could be the most successful that I've seen so far. There's a few more films of his I haven't seen yet. There's Wild at Heart, The Straight Story, Lost Highway, Inland Empire. So I've seen probably about 60% of his filmography, I think, in terms of feature films. But, you know, it feels in line with other things that he's done, but in that weird kind of way where you can, it's really open to interpretation, I feel like it might be the most successful. And I don't know, maybe I've been talking absolute bollocks for the past 30 minutes, I don't know, but suffice it to say, Mulholland Drive, I loved it. I really did love it. And I can't wait to watch it again and to kind of, I don't know, just get lost even deeper in this world and in the music that I love so much and the performances that I love so much. And the chemistry between, you know, Rita and Betty, I don't think it's the most dynamic relationship that we see in a film, but I'll be damned if I wasn't 110% invested in those two characters and what they were doing together. The way that Betty was just so devoted to helping this woman, to the point where she almost gets like her big break in Hollywood, potentially, and she kind of turns her back on it, you know, not completely, like in terms of like in her mind, like I'm not going to do this, but she has a chance to maybe meet a director, and she's like, oh no, I got to go help Rita, I'm leaving. You know, so she kind of, yeah, she really just drops everything to help this woman. And when you get to the end of the film, you can perhaps understand why. But suffice it to say again, I love the film. And it has, I think, maybe one of the best sex scenes I've ever seen. And if you know me, you know I'm not a big fan of sex scenes. And I think as far as a sex scene between two characters where there is nudity involved, and it could look from certain, you know, perspectives as being a kind of titillating and, you know, sex scene for the sex of showing, you know, a bit of nudity, I think that, yeah, it's so sensual. And I bought that these two characters were really passionately into each other, you know. And I saw in some of the interviews afterwards that, you know, they were both very nervous filming that scene and they weren't the most sure about it. But again, the way it turned out on screen, I just thought it was so passionate and involving and believable and sensual and erotic and not too much, which I really appreciated. So that scene was incredibly memorable to me and actually one of the highlights of the film. I never thought I'd say that a sex scene would be, I mean, it's not a complete sex, it's more of the foreplay and the beginning of a sexual encounter, but I just thought that it was brilliant, actually. Anyway, that's my thoughts on Mulholland Drive. I don't know whether to just do like a spoiler section to make it its own video at this point. I don't know. So maybe I'll do that and also talk about the Blu-ray and the special features. So we'll make this a kind of a bumper double bill edition talking about Mulholland Drive. So thank you for watching this part. Thanks, you know, for watching and hopefully for commenting. I'd love to hear your thoughts on this film. I really, really would. And I'm really excited to get back into this Lynch Fest stuff, which I will be running till the end of 2019. So there's a lot more things I want to talk about and make videos on in terms of the works of David Lynch and other things. So watch this space. Hope you enjoy what's to come. Hope you've enjoyed my ramblings on this film. And I'll see you in the next one.